Okay, are we good to go now?
Yes.
Looks great. Thanks.
Okay. So just a quick note. First, a big thanks to the rest of the team, David Chang and Dave B. They were great at the whole process and being volunteered for this. Although, special note to David Lopez, who actually volunteered for this. Even though he was on the team last time and could have got a free out, he stepped up to the plate for us. So the process we went through for developing our plan is we look back at the 2009 and the 2101 release testing and what they had accomplished, the number of tutorials they had done, the amount of time they had taken, and the number of items they had worked through, release notes and issues. One thing to point out is in the 2009, they actually went in and tried to fix the bugs that they identified. So they didn't get, you notice they only made it through three out of the 350 release note items. And they spent approximately 2 weeks doing that. So for the 2101, that process was streamlined quite a bit, where the testers just identified the bugs, opened issues, didn't actually fix things. So even though they only spent approximately 2 or 3 days for it, as opposed to approximately 2 weeks, they made it through more tutorials and many more release items. So that's sort of the process we followed for 2105. Also, we looked back at the recommendations from 2101. That we had made it at the 2101 release meeting, that we have more of a structured testing plan, that we open issues even more aggressively, you know, do it right away as opposed to waiting, you know, until after to do them. One complaint, or not complaint, but issue that was raised with the process of 2101, there was just simply too many items in the release notes to cover in 2101, there's 283. In the 2009, there's 350. So you'd slog away at this list, and the list just never got any smaller. So you didn't really have a good sense of getting anything done. So we tried to address that. It was not easy to identify out of those, you know, 300 and some issues, which are the ones that we should actually be paying attention to, which are the high priority items, which are the low priority items. It wasn't always clear how to test an issue. So we spent a lot of time at 2101 just figuring out what to do. Some of it may have been duplicated or could have been done by automated testing. Not everything is or should be testable on main. Main might not have the correct tools installed, or a test might require admin access, et cetera, et cetera. So for our release 25, or the 2105 release testing plan, the dev team went through the release notes and curated a small list of items that were the high priority items that we could focus on. I also went through all the pull requests and pulled out the pull requests that did have a section on, you know, somebody had checked the little box saying that it required manual testing, or there was instructions for manual testing. So out of the 369 pull requests, when I generated my release notes, 43 of those actually had instructions included on how to do the tests. And of course, the Galaxy Training Network tutorials for scenario-based testing. We followed basically the same testing protocol. When to open an issue, when not to open an issue, what we can ignore, and how to verify if a problem is relevant by testing against previous issues. Again, we're not fixing bugs. We're just trying to identify as many as we can in the limited time frame that we had set aside for this. So a quick summary of our results. We made it through 22 of the tutorials. Only 9 of the release note items, While that doesn't sound like a lot, there were only 10 items pulled out as curated as highly important by the dev team, and we made it through all but two of those. So actually, you know, in sense of, you know, being able to feel that we got a lot accomplished, at least we could look at that. And that one spreadsheet we had for tracking was mostly filled out. So that's, you know, makes us feel good. Of course, there was two other spreadsheets that were mostly empty, but that's beside the point. We managed to open 19 issues. I still have need to open these issues right away. I still have two I have to open, but those were actually found in one was the Singularity tutorial. One of the upstream repos now has a bug in it, so they need an issue opened. We only identified one actual blocking issue. I meant to actually check the pull requests to see if that has actually probably been merged. I know Marius had said it was going to be addressed before we got there. So out of the 22 tutorials we had done, 12 were from the admin, 8 Galaxy interface, and then 2 in the introduction. You know, so we did more of the admin tutorials, background stuff than anything else. Of the release notes that we had covered, 4 were bug fixes, 2 were new features, and 3 were enhancements. Now those, that should be taken with a grain of salt because that just goes by the kind label that was assigned. So these are not mutually exclusive. This should probably be a Venn diagram, not a pie chart, but it just sort of gives some idea of what is being covered. Again, we only covered 9 out of the 317. I noticed this is a different number here, probably generating slides and looking at pull requests at different times, which is why we have slightly different numbers. Again, we opened 19 issues. All of these 19 are open in the main Galaxy repo. I guess the big takeaway from this release testing, either our release process is getting much better, the testers are not doing as a good job, but we found no real major issues, all little, you know, niggling paper cuts mostly. No major issues found in the tutorials. We did, you know, add a few PRs with typos fixed. Some of the problems we identified, as I said, mostly paper cut in the paper cut issues in the user interface around data libraries and the workflow errors. I think this server error here, number 11986, that was the blocker that job handlers were acting as workflow schedulers when they shouldn't be doing that. The tutorials, again, no major problems, you know, some outdated screenshots, you know, as things evolve, those slowly, you know, suffer from bit rot. Sort of related to that is a lot of the changes that you're supposed to work through are expressed as patches or diff files that you're supposed to get to apply, and those almost never apply cleanly. Depending on what order you go through the tutorials, the line number might be wrong, the surrounding context might be different. So I found very few of those patches that actually applied unless I went in and edited them myself. And as I said, the minor typos were fixed on the spot. And then there is one irregularity that I had found with the way the noodles maintain state, but it's a pretty arcane error that you had to go through and disconnect and reconnect things in a certain order to expose that. So I think this is, well, I shouldn't say all of them, and that's 14 open and 20 closed, the issues that we had found. And there's the blocking issue is 11986 with the job handlers acting as workflow schedules. So just to recap, no major issues found. The release notes, those were really handy in making sure we laser focused on the items that we needed to. And then the automated classification of items based on the PR template that was used. You know, trying to avoid the ones that manually test or could be automated tested automatically or items that did have instructions for manually testing. But even if they did have instructions for manually testing, particularly for me, it wasn't always clear what they wanted us to test. The PR template helped a lot, but the people may have not filled out all of the steps. And it seems to me that, you know, that was written by domain experts for domain experts. You know, me coming from a non-biology background, a lot of the testing steps seem to be, you know, step one, sequence the human genome, step two, identify interesting variations, step three, verify that they're interesting variations. You know, so it would be nice if the instructions were, you know, click this button, go to this dialogue, click this button, make sure this thing turns green. Much more detailed steps on what needs to be done, almost like one of the Galaxy tours or the tutorials actually do, where it says, you know, click this tool, do this step. So the instructions could be a little bit more fine-grained. So this is sort of, again, a recap of the previous slide that we found. The testing much easier to do with a curated list of issues, but we didn't get through as many of them. Part of that is maybe due to point number three there, that we're also testing on Anvil and GVL instances. And I know for myself, I would usually start a test on Anvil I would start on Anvil or GVL. If I noticed a problem, then I would test on the other platform, then I would test it on main. Then I would try and find a 2101 instance, which I'd have to spin up on myself to see if it existed in 2101 or if it was regression. So just having that many platforms to test on tended to slow things down. A little bit. It allowed us to focus 100% on testing the release. And similarly with the availability of the virtual machines, both Anvil and GVL, of course, are running on virtual machines. But then we could also spin up specific Galaxy instances when people wanted to do admin testing. If they're running through any of the admin Ansible playbooks, that means you can't really be doing that on main. I'm sure Nate doesn't want us installing tools, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's nice to have these standalone VMs that we can work from. Some of the burn rates and comparisons of how we compared to past times. So here we can see the release. There were only three people doing testing. I'm not too sure. Marius was just listed as coordinator, not test. That should be bumped up to four, but they were at it for almost 2 weeks of 14 days. From their results, they covered three release notes and 21 tutorials. NPP is release notes per person per day and tutorials per person per day. So, you know, on average, they were only making it through half a tutorial per person per day. 2101, we can see those numbers increase quite a bit. They managed to do release notes, about three release notes per person per day and 2.5 of the tutorials. For the 2105, we didn't have as many people. We went about as long. We didn't cover as many release notes. As I said, that's possibly due to us having more instances to test against the GVL, Anvil, main, the other ones. So we only made it through about one release note per person per day, but our tutorials were up a little bit, did almost three tutorials per person per day. And this is just, you know, hopefully we can keep track of these numbers. So when it comes for the 2109, we can look and say, okay, we've got this many issues, we've got this many tutorials, we want to have this many people, so this is how many days we're going to need, or we have this many issues, this is how many days we want to spend, so we're going to need this many people. Just some numbers to, you know, make informed database decisions. Improvements that we could do better next time, and we already did it this time, we didn't pay any attention to the tool tests from the plan. It was listed in there, but we decided early that's a waste of time. It's already automated. We can maybe curate the list of tutorials to reduce a lot of the overlapping stuff. If we go through the rule-based uploader tutorial? Do we really need to go through the advanced rule-based uploading tutorial? Same with that. There's a number of on R and similar things. So those could be perhaps curated to focus on the big ones. The use of labels and tags to simplify the classification, how things should be tested as it is right now to see if something included instructions for manually testing. I would parse the body of the PR looking to see if they had put a little check mark in that little box beside includes instructions or whatever it was. So it was basically looking for a string match in the body. That becomes much easier if we just stick that in a label. I know there's been lots of discussion about how issues should be labeled. But if when somebody creates a PR, if they could just tag it in some way, it doesn't really matter what the tags or the labels are, as long as it's tagged in some way, either when the person creates the pull request or when the pull request is merged, maybe the person approving the merge can say, hey, yeah, we need to spend some time on this during the release testing. And of course, you know, just stress in the template how to do the manually testing with some very specific steps. As I said, you know, click this button, do this, do that. And screenshots are always handy. Again, reiterating the tags for PRs that need special attention. And it would be nice, and this is, you know, ongoing discussion always, how much of this can we automate with Selenium? There's ongoing work to try and use Galaxy Tours for Selenium tests, but we need to update the tours because a lot of those are broken currently, and they're probably going to break even more once the new history comes out, just based on, you know, where you're supposed to click on things. And then what would have been handy for this time is a side-by-side environment for testing new releases. When we did find a bug and we wanted to see if it was aggression, well, we didn't have a good 2101 instance. Now, I have sort of talked to Nate, and I would like to touch base with him. And this could be, you know, an opportunity for testing the recovery, disaster recovery plan. You know, if there's a plan, if something goes wrong with TAC, you know, major disaster, civil unrest, where Maine goes down and can't come back, what is the disaster recovery plan, and can we get that going a new instance? Well, it seems like release testing is a good time to test that. We can, you know, test our disaster backup, and that gives us the, you know, potentially a previous instance that we can use for regression testing. So we can sort of kill two birds with one stone, perhaps have the test instance, test.usegalaxy.org, or I forget if it's test.galaxyproject.org, maybe pin that during the release testing to the 2105 release as well. So we have something in addition to main that we can test against. And back to the ideas for improvement, not only can we automate a lot of the tests, we can automate a lot of the release testing process itself, generating release notes. This time, Marius went through manually and generated a lot of the stuff, but we can generate those release notes manually. It's literally a one-liner. It's all granted a long, ugly one-liner, but it's literally a one-liner with the GitHub CLI tool. So if we have some sort of label, either test manual or manual QA, it doesn't matter what the label is, but we can pull out just things with those labels. We can filter on other things as well. The state of the PR, is it opened? Is it closed? Has it been merged? We can search on what milestone it has targeted. We can search by what date it was merged or when it was created. And additionally, the GitHub PR or the GitHub CLI program can output JSON format and format that JSON with a Go template. So that's what I actually use to generate the spreadsheets that we worked from. And I talked to Marius about adding this to the make file so it could become part of the release process. And I was about to do that. And then I realized, well, this, it requires that you have the GitHub CLI tool installed locally. So I don't know if that's a good candidate for inclusion in the make file. I know there is a GitHub API already in the code that could be used for that, but this allowed me to, you know, generate the spreadsheets in a few moments.
I think maybe we can clarify here, this is not the release node generation. This is the reason release nodes are auto-generated. Yes. This is getting a list of issues you may or may not want to look at, because the way the release nodes are automated is they output HTML or well, Markdown or RST. I don't remember which one it is, but yeah, that's the idea.
I should clarify that. I'm sort of saying release notes, but that's not really the case. When I'm saying release notes, it's the list of issues that we have selected for testing and I put in the spreadsheet. So yeah, Marius makes a good point. That's not actually the release notes, which are human generated. It does it in RST, a restructured text, and also in HTML. But for my purposes, I want something that is machine readable and can be processed. So they're not really release notes, but they're a list of issues. So the other suggestions for improvements is that we start earlier, much earlier, not so much for the testing, but at least the process of setting up the tests. We know pretty much basically when the 2109 test is going to happen. So the picking the team should happen soon, at least the coordinator, so they can sort of get up to speed and get things in place. So hopefully everything is a button click when things are ready to go. The rest of the team should be, you know, picked before the code freeze happens, because what, you know, and I'd really like to thank the my teammates on this, because I sort of missed, I didn't sort of, I missed Marius's announcement when the release notes were published. So I didn't notice that for a couple of days after. So I picked the team in sort of a hurry and emailed everybody and got everybody going in short notice. So I'd like to thank the team for picking up the balls I kept dropping. So it'd be nice to let the team know much in advance so they can clear their calendar ahead out. Stress that, you know, I did send out that list of people to be curated by the PIs. You know, so if you get the email saying thank you for volunteering, you know that your PI is thought it was okay for you to do that. And again, this is another thing that can be automated, and that's what I did. I scraped the participant pool from the working group spreadsheet on Google Docs, eliminated people that were either PIs, had already participated in the release testing. Sysadmin's named Nate got excused. So once I had the list of people, I just selected N names at random. And N can be based on the amount of testing to be done. As I had said, we can, you know, we sort of got some burn rates. So if we identify how many issues we need to look at, how many tutorials we want to look at, we can do some math, figure out what N should be, and then select the names. And so that is all from me. I'll stop sharing my screen and we can have some discussion.
Thanks, Keith.
One of the suggestions you mentioned for future potential suggestion for the future is requiring tests for bug fixes and features. We discussed it in 2009 during the 2009 release testing, and the consensus was to put it off until better times because writing tests was hard, is hard, and there was no documentation. We have documentation now. We have great guidance on how to write a test and what test to choose, mainly thanks to John. So I'm wondering, should we gently start trying to require tests in these cases like other major repos do? For example, if you fix a bug, it's only natural to have a bug identify, a test identifying, exposing the bug. What do you think?
I think, you know, that's a great idea, sort of, you know, test-based development. The first, I think, any bug fix should come with a test that exposes the bug. So you know what you're fixing, and then you know when you're done fixing it because your test passes.
But can we reasonably, you know, require the community to write those, or do we have the time and resources to help in each case when there is a PR, which is good, but lacks a test, and the person who submitted the fix doesn't know how to write the test?
I want to push back on that. So first, we added the template as a sort of small nudge towards writing tests. I hate the template. We've had it now for 3 months. I think it's a waste of time. Because we're getting very few PRs from the community at this point. And so they were meant mostly for the community. Everybody should be writing good commit notes already. And if you have a good commit note, then that messes, the template messes with it, right? You need to edit it, you need to go in. And then, you know, not every test is a good test, right? So you can have tests that fix a certain behavior that we may want to change, or we have some integrations that are difficult to set up, like all the OIDC auth. So I would say, like, you know, as a reviewer, you can always request tests. You can always write the tests yourself. As somebody that reviews a lot of PRs, I think it's good to be able to, you know, if somebody comes up with a bug fix, say yes, thank you, and merge it and move on, because there's also a ton of code we don't care about. We get a pull request from somebody who's the only person using it. So that's my two cents. I follow the pull request template, and I can see how the template itself is nice, getting contribution from the outside, and maybe it's not exactly obvious how you test them, but they're not meant for general public. They're meant for us reviewing, not for release testing, I think.
So would it be safe to say that it would be great and really, you know, the preferred way for each PR to come in with a test?
In
an ideal world, right? You would, right? But it's like, yes, we can be willing to accept things if it's prudent to do so without a test, right? But I think making testing, you know, like a soft requirement, like a hard soft requirement, like really preferred, you know, make sure people are aware that we want to have good testing. We want to have 100% testing, right? Like, that's what we would love to have, but from a practical standpoint, maybe it's not possible.
For certain types of PRs, it would be good if it were at least a soft requirement. Not all types of PRs. And speaking of the template, first of all, yeah, I'm with Marius. It's annoying. I know how to write a good PR message, which includes all those points in my own formatting, which is much more readable, I think. But I see the point. And what we could do, if the community considers that we do need a template, we can have different types of templates for different types of PRs. I believe SQL Alchemy has that. If you are submitting a bug fix, you get one template. If you are submitting a feature or a question, a minor change, that's a different template. So that's one thing. But in terms of requiring tests, as a soft requirement, if you found a bug, well, try to write a test. If it's some kind of configuration change which does not require an obvious test, well, then no.
I think if it's a functional test, we should require it, because anybody who can write code should be able to write a functional unit test. But if it's an integration test where you have a database, you have a server, et cetera, those are more difficult to set up and test and automate. So I think the middle ground would be, if you're changing one function, write a test to test it. If you're writing a change that affects multiple systems, then you know it's okay if you manually test it for now.
You mean unit test, right? The simple one.
Yeah, unit and functional tests should be mandatory. Integration tests, it depends, I would say.
Yeah, and usually
trying to clarify, these need to be good, right? They need to prevent us, they should not prevent us from working in the future, because we first have to understand whether the unit test or the functional test or whatever is relevant or not. And that's a challenge.
Well, that would be part of the review. If somebody submits a unit test, which is, you know, meaningless, that shouldn't get merged. You know, they have to either fix it, remove it, or... I mean, one problem I face in, you know, in support of your point, I've seen tests that have dependency between them. I mean, ideally, a test, you should be able to run unit tests in any order, random order. But there are dependencies. So if it runs, one of them runs before the other, you'd see an issue. If it runs in the other direction, you don't. So if somebody submits a test that depends on some other test, you know, obviously you have to say, you know, to break these up. So there should be no dependency between two subsequent tests.
Absolutely. Our code base is not perfect. And this particular example you bring up has been on the to-do list and now on the test working group to-do list for, well, it's been on the to-do list for at least 2 years, I think.
And hopefully the time you spend up front writing these tests will be saved in someone not having to debug something later on, right? That's the whole goal, right?
It's not a time wasted in my experience.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's orders of magnitude in the long run.
I mean, if you start with it, sure. If you come in afterwards, I'm not so sure.
Yeah, we don't want to scare someone away from fixing a quick bug on some large complicated thing, right? So because now they feel obligated to write a test for something that should have had tests to begin with, but for whatever reason do not.
I guess that was my question. Let's say there was like the most trivial bug present, you know, it's a one character fix. What would be the minimum tests that could kind of get integrated in? Can you have an equally simple test? Or I mean, usually the problem with testing is you have to like have this whole harness and a lot of, you know, infrastructure behind that. But are we in a position where, you know, a really simple test could be almost a one-liner in itself?
It depends on what the character is. If it's a Galaxy's code base is not all of it is easily testable. So if it's a character, wrong character in a simple isolated function which can be run without mocking up half of Galaxy, then sure, it's a tiny little unit test. But if that little character, wrong character, is part of a 300 line or 1,000 line method or function which cannot be easily isolated, then it's a very non-trivial testing case which actually requires not just writing a clever test, but refactoring that part of Galaxy, like breaking a whole lot of dependencies, factoring out this 300 line method into something more modular, et cetera, et cetera. Depends.
And I would go out on a limb and suggest if there's a huge block of code that's 300 to thousands of lines long, that is difficult for unit testing, that we open an issue and say, this section of code needs to be refactored so we can do unit testing on it. Now that's always easier said than done, but at least identify, you know, and tag it with something that says, oh, part of the testing and hardening framework, if you want to do something, here's a section of code. Refactor it, and your tests are that, hey, now we can test this section of code reliably with unit tests.
Yeah, but we might exceed the GitHub's limit on the number of open issues.
Yeah, that's everything in lib, right?
Yeah, I did not realize GitHub had a limit on open issues.
We might push them into creating one. But yes, in general, yes, absolutely. That's what we should be doing. That's what we should be aiming for.
Yeah, these are sort of pie in the sky goals.
I'm going to say this. I mean, I'm okay with it if we want to require tests and be, you know, more strict with the reviews. That's fine. But then I want more people reviewing. We don't have enough people reviewing, because oftentimes it falls on the reviewer to, you know, write them or ask multiple times or, you know, nudge people. It's especially when finishing up the release, it's a big burden. You know, even if you're not a committer, you can review stuff.
What about, so committers, yeah, it requires a committer to merge something, but what about what if the testing group could be available to add tests to things when they're requested? So like, let's say you look at something in Aries and you're like, this would be better with a test. I don't know if this person's ever going to get to it. Let me just ping the testing group. And
the testing group is all committers, right? So we're already spread pretty
thin. Is it all
committers? I mean, Oleg is not, I think, but Oleg could be, I mean, but yeah.
Yeah, I would say everyone in the testing group has another group where they're probably a little more vital. Oleg, Marius, myself.
Solution to that, everyone should be in the testing group for that matter.
I mean, this is fair. I don't want to derail the conversation too much, but I'm a little saddened to hear that the template isn't going well. As I mean, I'm a person who used to write very like intricate PRs. I've had short bandwidth lately, but I've liked the section where you're specifying how to test the code at least. I mean, I feel like that seems like it's had the right desired effect to nudge people in a certain direction. And I would think it would help the release people. Is it the top two sections we don't like, or is it any sort of template we don't like?
I mean, for whom is this meant? Because I write it in a way, you know, the shortest way that you can, you know, either try it or, you know, reproduce the bug. And oftentimes it's anyway redundant with the tests included.
But isn't there like, we've included the tests, isn't there just a checkbox for that? Like,
I guess I get you to write it all, I don't know.
You just check existing test coverage, new tests, or...
I didn't see this as one of them.
Yeah, the goal was, I mean, yeah, the original template didn't have it, but then I was like, I just added a test. I don't want to like rewrite all this stuff out. So I think we added just like, so what I do is I check there's a test here or there's an existing test and then I just delete the other lines. I would think the manual piece was there just in case, you know, the other ones didn't go through. It meant as like an if else sort of thing.
Yeah, that's how I do it. I just delete those lines usually if there's a test.
So that way, if you don't have a test, you do have to write out the steps, right? And so that's why it is encouraging people to do the automated testing. I mean, it's a small thing to write out how to manually test it compared to writing the test case, but it does, you know, it's a little thing to nudge people in the right direction, I think.
I don't think I have a problem with that particular section of the template. It's actually at the bottom. It doesn't get in the way, and it provides valuable structured information regarding testing. I think my annoyance was, as you said, the first two parts. What did you do and why did you do it? Sometimes the justification or explanation does not fit well in two paragraphs with two headings. So if we eliminate that structure, maybe it will be more flexible.
So just one paragraph, what did you do and why did you do it?
Or yeah, justification maybe.
Overview, whatever, call it whatever, but.
I mean, the template already doesn't jive with our recommendation of how you write a commit message, right? So, you know, you open a PR from a commit and you've carefully written your message and now you have to pick it apart, rewrite it, and it doesn't match your commit message anymore.
But the PR usually contains more than one commit messages, so it doesn't really have to match the commit message. I almost feel it's my academic past. I feel like I'm plagiarizing myself when it's the same.
Yeah, so I mean, based on this conversation, I guess my preference would be we merge those first two sentences and we put them in a like parentheses, like replace this with a description of how to do X and Y, you know, and be sure to include what you're doing and why you're doing it, link to relevant issues, et cetera. But I mean, obviously I added the stuff for the licensing stuff, which I think is nice, right? Now we're forcing everyone to MIT license their contributions. Yeah, so I mean, I get it though, because I frequently, when I was writing PRs before, sometimes I would put the justification first and sometimes I would put what I'm doing first. And it sort of depended on, you know, just the story I wanted to tell. Maybe we should iterate on it rather than throwing it out, I guess is what I'm saying.
I like replace.
I guess clarify that section about testing, that like just delete the sections that are irrelevant to you.
I mean, I think there could be good time savings for us actually also if we add the issue template. I think it's a bit more applicable there and it saves us the issues that don't belong on the GitHub repo and that should go to help.
I like that idea a lot.
And the common things people forget to mention, like which release are you on?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
I mean,
And I actually had the number. I forgot to write it down. I did do a comparison, and I think out of the 369 issues that we had, 150 some of them used the release template or that PR template. Marius by far was the biggest committer of PRs that use the template. So he has the most experience with that. He also was the biggest defender of merged PRs that didn't use the template, but those were all one-liners that, you know, that template gets in the way when, oh, you merged release into dev or bumped the version, you know, things like that don't really need. So about half of them used that template.
Were the ones that didn't, did they just predate the template?
No, because I only, now when did the template come out? That was, because I only looked at PRs since the last release test phase. So I think we finished
after the last release process meeting. So there were going to be some PRs in there.
Yeah.
What John said, maybe our template should be not a template fill in the blanks, but a template as guidelines to how to write. Include this, this, and this, and this. Then you're free to use your own format as long as you stick to the guidelines.
Well, I still want the footer in every PR.
Yes, footer would be fine. I liked what you suggested about not here is the header and include this, but rather replace this with for the top part.
I'll do a PR to do that, I guess. Does someone want to take on the issue template? Any volunteers to start that going?
I can try.
All you.
Thank you, Sergey.
So issue template, right?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Mention the Galaxy version, mention help dealing with the application belongs somewhere else. What else, Marius, were you saying should, what other?
I think that's the most common things. Which version, ideally which commit, if you know it.
Which Galaxy server you were using, if it's something like that.
Yeah.
Should we mention who it impacts? Like if we're fixing something.
It should be lightweight, right?
like, again, shouldn't go in the way. It should really just be as small as possible.
Okay.
Yeah, what went wrong, how to reproduce it, and the circumstances of this.
Right. So when I make issue tickets against tools, I'll make it an issue at the repository, and then I'll have sort of what caused the problem and if it impacted users or, you know, like, because we're making software, we want people to be able to use it and like using it. And so I think sometimes you might want to prioritize things based on whether it's core and it breaks Galaxy, or it makes the experience better, or it doesn't. And then when I make a separate issue that's in the Use Galaxy playbook, it's like user focused. I put the workaround, but then I also put the development stuff so that it's how to reproduce it. And those could definitely become test cases. So like I'll have exactly what the inputs are, what the environment was, and then like where the problem was and what it should look like. And then you can just rerun those. And if that works, I know that it's done and it's finished. And I wonder if we could sort of adopt that in the development area in some way where you've got sort of a place that shows where it's broken and then how you can tell if it's fixed or not in an abstracted way. I just tend to do mine a little scientific, but you want to kind of abstract that to know that it's finished. Am I making sense or silence? No.
What's the expected behavior, right?
Right. So what's like what the issue was, and then what it should look like when it's done. And so I tend to list all that out, especially for small tool issues that are kind of complex, right, to define. There's just an example. It's got small data. It's representative. It shows where the problem is. I do comparisons between different servers and releases, including just the local that I spin up. So it's got some context. And then when you can just rerun those really quick. And then if it works, you know, the expected result matches. And all of that is written out. But that could be a test, right? That could be if you're trying to fix something. No? Because I stopped doing that.
Yeah, I mean, we want to keep it simple. I mean, you know, people just want to write something, that's fine, but like, it's just a small reminder, please include the version. That's usually the most common thing. And for everything else, you know, I mean, the only thing we really need to react to is bugs. And if the bugs don't include the version or what it was, it just takes so much more time. After that, it's free for everyone to write them. But I also want to remind people to be concise, because, if it's too long, I don't know. It's also a problem.
Okay, so it's like context. Okay, that's what I'm trying to say. It's like the context of the bug, I think, is important to know about, and that might help rank what we want
to. Yeah, but I mean, if that doesn't come to you naturally, I don't think we should force it.
And sometimes the context isn't helpful in solving the bug, right? So if it's some tool form issue, some widget is wrong, a bunch of context about the scientific application or the particular tools. Sometimes those are helpful, but then sometimes, you know, they sort of shroud the underlying issue that might,
right.
Like a developer might be like, oh yeah, I just need to, these radio boxes need to be a checkbox, right? Like,
there's like a tendency also to put like many things in one issue, and that's also not helpful because then you don't even know where to start what the actual problem is. If you ask for too much context, you're going to get too much context.
Okay. I'm just wondering, like, how have we found the original bug? That person knows where the problem, like, how it was encountered and how it, the context of the usage. I'm wondering if that would help us to prioritize what to test. Right, if you knew there's certain things that are going to impact our users that are going to make them like using Galaxy or not like using Galaxy.
I mean, users shouldn't be posting issues, right? I mean, you know, I mean, expert power users, yes. Otherwise, that should go to help. I think, I mean, like, I don't, you know, have the monopoly on that opinion. This is for developers.
Yeah.
Right. I guess what I'm wondering is what I was doing for tools that have that are broken and have fixes, if that part of it, we could automate that gen part of it, right? Where I'm describing what it is and how to reproduce it and how to tell if it's fixed. If there's a way we can make that into a tool test, right? Rather than somebody having to go click around and... I've stopped doing that, and then it comes up again. And then when I'm going through, and the pre-release first shows up on main, you know, I go through a bunch of things that I knew were problems before, and I go back and check them. And so I'm wondering should I write those differently? Is there something that I could add at that point? Or that others who are reporting notice issues that they could include. And I guess that goes back to the unit test, but I guess I'm thinking about priority. Like how do we know what the testing team should be testing? And if it's infrastructure, that's in one pile. If it's user experience, that's another pile. And I'm not sure if the G10 tutorials are going to cover everything because they're pretty simple. So anyway, I'll stop now because everyone has a confused look on their face.
So. No, I mean, I think it's valuable insight. I just figuring out how to do that well, right? It requires a lot of coordination and such. But
right. I'd like to provide something that isn't as manual if I report something, you know, that I noticed, because it's...
Yeah, maybe we should stop here, but one thought I've had is that, you know, some simple tags like, you know, it would be called like issue detected on main, and what that tag could really mean is, well, we need to like, you know, Jen or someone, you know, the release testing team, or maybe it's Jen, you know, maybe it's because it's linked to an infrastructure ticket, should retest this after the release or something. But it's hard to figure out exactly how to do that. And I mean, a lot of the issues tend to be like complex beasts, right? With many different layers. So it's hard to say exactly when an issue is done and deployed and the user experience is fixed or not.
Okay, yeah, because I've dropped out of that. I don't know if that's harming or hurting. And I do keep track of things to, or I was until about 3 months ago, I got overloaded. Of things to retest in the new release, just to make sure that they were actually, and that might be a GUI issue or something that is part of Galaxy itself, not necessarily a tool. But, you know, I'm like a year behind on checking out those and I close them out. And I'm wondering if there's a way that I could submit that in a way that it was easier to have it just be done and known, rather than a big long list with screenshots and click here, click that, do that, here's a history, here's a comparison history, here's a, you know.
Yeah, we should table this discussion for another day, because it would be good to have a way to delegate that to the release team or to automation or whatever, but probably we've only got a couple minutes here.
Okay.
So I guess maybe we'll wrap it up here. Thanks to Keith and the team and the good discussion. Good Thursday, everyone. I'm stopping the recording.
Thanks, everyone.
All right.